Well, like many beginning booksellers, what we do is we end up working in bookstores, just because we hang out in them so much. And eventually what happens, we get hired by the people that were hanging around in their store so much, because they figure, well, what the hell, you're here so much, you might as well get a job. And that's how it started with me. Love of reading, the love of books, it all comes down through my mother. She always encouraged me. She constantly bought me books when I was younger. Took me to the library, got tired of paying the library fines because I would refuse to bring back the books. Not because it was a kid thing, I'm sure, I just didn't want to relinquish them, I wanted to keep them. So I started buying books. Eventually I started looking into the used bookstores, and I would find books that I would see in garage sales for, 10 cents, 20 cents, and I would see them for $2 or $3 in the bookstore. So I got the idea of buying the books for 10 cents a piece at a garage sale, selling them to the bookstore owner for 20 cents, and then doubling my money, and then I could buy more books or comics, whatever I wanted, in the used bookshop. People come in, for the most part, they're not really prepared to browse. Some do, but a lot of them have a specific idea of the book that they currently want. And they'll say, do you have this? And I can figure out within a few seconds whether we have it or not. And then I apologize if we do not have it, and I'm grateful if I do have it.
With every awkward silence, I'd offered him tea, and he'd taken it. How many cups did we have? 20, 30, or near as? I was out of milk and preciously low on sugar. He was just as finicky as before he'd left. Lifting the sugar into the tea like it was gold, stirring enough to wear a hole in the bottom of the cup, tapping the spoon to dislodge the stray drops like a clangor on a bell, and then, of course, blowing on the tea before he drank it. I thought he'd take it hot like a man after being in the RAF for so long, but he slurped, the noise going through me like a fork scratching on a plate. So the book is Small Island, and it's by Andrea Levy, and she's a British author of Caribbean descent. And I chose the book because it's one of my favourite ones of hers. It's a description of how her parents came from the Caribbean to the UK during the war, and it talks a lot about the class system in Britain and her parents' struggle. I mean, it's fiction, but it's based on her parents, and it's just really well written, really beautifully written, and it touches on a lot of subjects that I'm interested in, social injustice and feminism.
Yeah, and it was really descriptive about making the tea too.
Oh, it was incredibly descriptive about making the tea, and as I'm British, it seemed appropriate for me to read that. And I think the description of how he makes the tea is clearly a reflection of the person that he is, and how maybe particular he is, and maybe how disciplined he is as well. A man of the RAF, so.
This is an early edition of The Tale of Mrs. Tittlemouse by Beatrix Potter. It's a 1940 edition, nothing truly special or remarkable about the publication and its date. Not a first edition by any stretch of the imagination. However, she did take a time to actually sign it, which is spectacular on its own. So this was signed to a Canadian soldier who was wounded, I don't know how exactly, but he was convalescing, and he managed to find her and approached her, and she signed six books, which were then given to his children later on in life, and they each received two, and I've bought two so far.
At birth, a person is flexible and flowing. At death, the person becomes rigid and blocked. Consider the lives of plants and trees. During their time of greatest growth, they are relatively tender and pliant. But when they are full grown or begin to die, they become tough and brittle. The tree, which has grown up and become rigid, is cut into lumber. The rigid group leader may be able to lead repetitious and structured exercises, but can't cope with lively group process. Whatever is flexible and flowing will tend to grow. Whatever is rigid and blocked will atrophy and die. This is from The Tower of Leadership by John Hayter. It's just a translation of the Tao Te Ching. I'm not pronouncing that right, but yeah. I guess I chose this because, I don't know, right now in life I'm feeling like it's sort of the paradox of being stable and the paradox of always being willing to change. And through stability we can grow, but also if we're completely stationary, obviously nothing can grow. So it's like the give and take.
This is original illustration from Punch magazine. This is illustrated by Ernest Shepherd. He's the gentleman who illustrated, funny enough, Wind in the Willows, but he also is very famous for Winnie the Pooh, which he regretted doing for many years because that's all he became known for. These, again, very lovely illustrations, very whimsical, of course. And, you know, this runs about $5,000. However, if one of these characters was a Winnie the Pooh drawing, the starting price would have been about $40,000. So that's a big stretch. And I'll show you one more thing. I just have to get it here. Hold on. More stuff. Now this is cool. This is a children's book written by H.G. Wells. And this is his two children. These are actually photographs of his actual children. And what it is it's a manual on how to play with toys. So he sets up different scenarios that you can use with your soldiers and your and all your different characters, and he took the photographs, and then he set this up for his kids, and of course, obviously for other children, because this book was sold quite widely, I imagine. So that's the only book with his children in it. There you go. So, and that's just a handful of things. Obviously, there's a lot more.
I started working in bookstores when I was 14, I think. I had summer jobs in a series of different stores. And then when I finished university, I was unemployable, you might say. And I happened to know a lot about books. So I had someone who was going to help me set up my first store. I was in 1983, I think. And I've had many stores since then. I've lost track of how many. There's probably about 12 or 13, 14, something like that. And so I guess I have 30 years experience now, which is about what it takes to really understand how to run the used bookstore. I find, you know, interesting books will sell to interesting people. That's sort of my motto if I had one. So as long as I keep being a bit particular about what I take into the store, and eventually someone will come who has been looking for that book or sees it as something interesting. I think that's the main job. My main job is deciding what ends up on my shelves and what doesn't. I came up with to describe the store in some ways is order must be maintained, chaos maintains itself. That kind of describes what goes on here.
The door opened, and a family came in fresh from church, the mother and daughter dressed alike in navy with white Peter Pan collars. Light streamed in the door, hazy, warped, blurred with drizzles of yellow. The little girl sneezed, and her mother said, "Come here, let's wipe your nose." I looked again at the honey jars, at the amber light swimming inside them, and made myself breathe slowly. I realized it for the first time in my life. There is nothing but mystery in the world, how it hides behind the fabric of our poor, browbeat days, shining brightly, and we don't even know it. I thought about the bees that had come to my room at night, how they'd been part of it all, and the voice I'd heard the day before saying, "Lily Melissa Owens, your jar is open," speaking as plain and clear as the woman in navy speaking to her daughter. I like the passage. Well, I love this book in general because I enjoy reading about bees, and I like bee imagery as well. I find it really wonderful to read about. But I chose this passage because I feel like it resonates with where I'm at in my life right now in terms of feeling like feeling open to the world and wanting to be open to the world and open to experiences. And I feel like she, in this moment, the character Lily, she's realizing that, and she's realizing how much mystery there is in the world, and how wonderful it all is, and just to take a second to appreciate it and to want to feel open to the possibilities of what that mystery might entail for you. Yeah, I like it.
My father's family name being Pirup and my Christian name Philip, my infant tongue could make of both names nothing longer or more explicit than Pip. So I called myself Pip and came to be called Pip. It's just a great opening that kind of sets the mood for the book and really introduces you to the character, lets you kind of know of he's kind of a wanderer throughout the book trying to find his identity, and his unfixed name is just kind of an interesting way to let you know about him.
Chapter 8, A Lunar Morning. The harsh emphasis, the pitiless black and white of the scenery had altogether disappeared. The glare of the sun had taken upon itself a faint tinge of amber. The shadows upon the cliff of the crater wall were deeply purple. To the eastward, a dark bank of fog still crouched and sheltered from the sunrise, but to the westward the sky was blue and clear. I began to realize the length of my insensibility. We were no longer in a void. An atmosphere had arisen about us. The outline of things had gained in character, had grown acute and varied, save for a shadowed space of white substance here and there, white substance that was no longer air but snow. The Arctic appearance had gone altogether. Everywhere, broad, rusty brown spaces of bare and tumbled earth spread to the blaze of the sun. Here and there, at the edge of the snowdrifts, were transient little pools and eddies of water, the only thing stirring in that expanse of barrenness. The sunlight inundated the upper two-thirds of our sphere and turned our climate to high summer, but our feet were still in shadow and the sphere was lying upon a drift of snow.
Oh, disorienting.
Yeah. Oh. So this is from H.G. Wells' The First Men in the Moon. It originally appeared piece by piece in a magazine, and that's partly why I like it. I like to think of how people reading it could just get a little piece each week, and how it kind of had, or it kind of created a community for everyone who was maybe reading the book at the time. Like, you got to discover it together. And I really like how it takes, they go to the moon and it's a completely different place and time, and I love the description and the imagination of it.
Ralph looked at him dumbly, For a moment, he had a fleeting picture of the strange glamour that had once invested the beaches. But the island was scorched up like dead wood. Simon was dead, and Jack had. The tears began to flow and sobs shook him. He gave himself up to them now for the first time on the island. Great shuddering spasms of grief that seemed to wrench his whole body. His voice rose under the black smoke before the burning wreckage of the island. And infected by that emotion, the other little boys began to shake and sob too. In the middle of them, with filthy body, matted hair, and unwiped nose, Ralph wept for the end of innocence, the darkness of man's heart, and the fall through the air of the true wise friend called Piggy. The book is The Lord of the Flies by William Goldring. And I wouldn't say it's my favorite passage, but I remember reading that when I was in the 7th or 8th grade. And that was the last part of the book. And I just remember it kind of, it kind of came all crashing down on me, kind of the conclusion of the book, and the part about the darkness in man's heart I found very compelling, and kind of it shook me reading about how it shook him.
All right. This is Ozymandias by Percy Shelley. I met a traveler from an antique land who said, "Two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them, on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read which yet survive stamped on these lifeless things. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed, and on that pedestal these word appear. My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away." And that's it. Yeah, like this. Just finding someone talking about how find a big old statue, and it's like, hey, you know, this guy thought he was like the business, but he's really not. Like, look, he's like nothing now, and the only thing that remains is like this artwork that was based on him, and it wasn't even his work, it was like this sculptor's work. So the sculptor's stuff survived, and this guy's, he didn't. So yeah. I just think it's really interesting.
Templeton crept into the crate and buried himself in the straw. He got out of sight just in time. Lurvy and John Arable and Mr. Zuckerman came along at that moment, followed by Mrs. Arable and Mrs. Zuckerman and Avery and Fern. Wilbur had already decided how he would carry the egg sack. There was only one way possible. He carefully took the little bundle in his mouth and held it there on the top of his tongue. He remembered what Charlotte had told him, that the sack was waterproof and strong. It felt funny on his tongue and made him drool a bit, and of course he couldn't say anything. But as he was being shoved into the crate, he looked up at Charlotte and gave her a wink. She knew he was saying goodbye in the only way he could, and she knew her children were safe. "Goodbye," she whispered. Then she summoned all her strength and waved one of her front legs at him. She never moved again. Next day, as the Ferris wheel was being taken apart and the racehorses were being loaded into the vans and the entertainers were packing up their belongings and driving away in their trailers, Charlotte died. The fairgrounds were soon deserted. The sheds and buildings were empty and forlorn. The infield was littered with bottles and trash. Nobody, of the hundreds of people that had visited the fair, knew that a gray spider had played the most important part of all. No one was with her when she died. It's Charlotte's Web by E.B. White. It's a very poignant way of discussing death, which is still very much a taboo subject. And as a child, you know, it's very difficult to, it's difficult to introduce because it's something that, it's not something that's always present, and yet it is in a way. And when I was young, it actually resounded with me a lot because it actually, something like, it affected me personally from a very young age, and it was a very nice way of acknowledging it, mm-hmm. and acknowledging the people in our lives who make life worthwhile.
One last word, I said in my horrible, careful English. Are you quite sure that, well, not tomorrow, of course, not after tomorrow, but, well, someday, any day, you will not come to live with me? I will create a brand new god and thank him with piercing cries if you give me that microscopic hope. No, she said, smiling. No. It would have made all the difference, said Humbert. This is Lolita by Vladimir Nabokov. I picked it because this is after she's left Humbert. She is many years older than when he knew her. She's pregnant with a new husband, and he still has this divine dream that one day this girl will come back to him. And I think it's such a interesting image of his horrendous love for her that's more of a toxin than something that we would consider as beautiful love. Yeah.
She wrote this. Let me see. This 202 years ago.
Wow.
Yesterday. Well, that was published a little bit later, but so here is her universal truth that she starts off in the first line of the book, chapter one. Oh, by the way, the book is Pride and Prejudice by Jane Austen, an English author. It is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife. Now, every girl I've shown that to agrees with it. And so does the English people. In fact, they think so much of Jane Austen that they're going to put her picture on the pound note beside the Queen. That's how good Jane Austen writes. Now, she writes very good description, long sentences and short, but some of them are descriptive, but there's always a sense of humor behind. And shall I read some more? Why, my dear, you must know. Mrs. Long says that Netherwell is taken by a young man of large fortune from the north of England, that he came down on Monday in a chaise and four to see the place and was so much delighted with it that he agreed with Mr. Morris immediately that he is to take possession before Michaelmas, and some of his servants are to be in the house by the end of the week. What is his name? Bingley. Is he married or single? No, just... Oh, single, my dear, to be sure. A single man of large fortune, 4,000 or 5,000 a year. What a fine thing for our girls. How so? How can it affect them? My dear Mr. Bennet, replied his wife, how can you be so tiresome? You must know that I'm thinking of his marrying one of them. Is that his design in settling here? Design? Nonsense. How can you talk so? But it's very likely that he may fall in love with one of them, and therefore you must visit him soon as he comes.
Thank you. There is an east wind coming, Watson. I think not, Holmes. It is very warm. Good old Watson, you're the one fixed point in a changing age. There's an east wind coming all the same, such as winds never blew on England yet. It will be cold and bitter, Watson, and a good many of us may wither before its blast. But it's God's own wind nonetheless, and a cleaner, better, stronger, and will stronger land will lie in the sunshine when the storm has cleared. Start her up, Watson, for it's time that we were on our way. I have a check for £500, which should be cashed early, for the drawer is quite capable of stopping it, if he can.
Okay, so could you say what book and passage that's from and why you chose that?
Sure, so that's from His Last Bow, the last Sherlock Holmes novel by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. And it's the last time that Sherlock Holmes talks to Watson, and they're older, and it's a really poignant scene that I really enjoy, because he kind of predicts the war in it, and he's talking about how things are going to get hard, and he kind of also says goodbye. So I thought it was really a sweet scene.
Yeah, I like it too.
Oh, hi, sorry,
I started because I'd failed at everything else I had done. I had no education, no background, but I'd been a reader all my life. And I got a job at a new bookstore, and I saw that I was very well suited to that. So I started accumulating books in order to open my own store, which I did, and I've been doing it ever since. And the reason I've accumulated all these books is because all I ever wanted to do was buy books. So I buy way more books than I sell. And I like being here surrounded by all my books. So this is my fifth store, and I've set them all up myself. And I plan them all out, but not with any particular town. I've just done it by moving things around. In my early days in a store, I would sit there late at night and look around and say, well, I'll move this here and I'll move that there. So yes, this is my creation, and this is the way I want it to be, the way I want to show the books, and so I've done it all myself. I've even built most of the shelves except these ones. So you seem to grasp that this is in fact itself a work of art. Very few people would ever get a concept like that, but we're setting up the books so that the books tell their own story, yes. Mostly the people I get in are people from all over the world who are looking for rare books in the fields they know I deal in. Booksellers send people on from one place to another. So if someone's coming here from London or New York and they're a collector, they'll say to the bookseller there, where would I go in Toronto? And they'll tell them where to go. And that happens all around the world. And we all know each other, and people get sent around. So mostly in a place like this, after all, we're in a basement of an office building with no sign out. And mostly what we get are people looking for a specific book that they either know we have or they think we have a good chance of having, or an area, field of collecting interest. So this is now more a collector's bookstore than a general use bookstore, which is what I was doing when I was your age. There was a time, no longer, but there was a time when I could tell you where I bought every book I have here, who I bought it from, what I paid for, but those days are gone. I had a phenomenal memory when I was young, but things like that go with age, and my partner mostly runs things here now. But yes, there is. I look at books, and I can see books that I bought from an old customer who died or that I bought from another bookseller. So yeah, every book means something to me. And unlike an ordinary used bookstore, because I have now gotten so big and have to weed out, almost every book in here are books that I have chosen to keep, or either chosen to buy or then chosen to keep. So in the early days, you see you buy a whole house full of books and you put the books in your store until they sell. But I can no longer do that. I have to pick and choose. So just about every book in here is here for a reason.
Thank you.
This store is twice as big as the old store, which enables us to spread out more, give our customers more space to walk. The aisles are much larger, which does help. So we'll be able to accommodate more customers, hopefully. And that's it. It was pretty much flawless until the very last day, when it was just a mad scramble to get basically everything ready. And there was a lot of problems with, you know, bits and pieces and trying to fit it all into boxes. But we basically moved about 130,000 books in total. Yeah, it's still going on.
Yeah.
So we're still in the process. So we're clearing all the aisles of boxes, trying to get it all ready for customers. In fact, we've been very busy since we moved over to the north side of the street, which seems to be a much more favorable location. And which I attribute mainly probably to the subway system, the fact that it's on the north side of the street. People get off the subway on the north side, they walk along the north side, we're on the north side. It's not there yet. Okay, Superman's reign.
He's making a play. First to kneel, he will lay. With neatly joints, words all new. Then the bottom, he'll round. And the chisel, the sound, and the fasten the verse with the glue. A maxim he'll take, an epithet he'll make. And call the new names what is old.
Oh, yeah, that's
you
nice.
Form it like wax, and fill in the cracks, and cast in the last of the mold. That's a paragraph from The Olympic Heroes. This is a book that I found in Doug Miller's bookstore. That paragraph was taken from one of the short stories called The Promise of Zeus. And it's the reason why I like reading these kind of books is because it adds to the person's learning, but it kind of gives you a different perspective of how life was in a different time and different cultures, and you kind of just appreciate life all because it's so versatile. It's a good selection, this bookstore. I've been to a different amount of bookstores in the city, and I always keep coming back to this one because I always find something new and something interesting.
Ivy clung to the walls and pigeons huddled beneath the gables, resting their wings. It was a nice old building with character. A great oak tree stood in the schoolyard, and a column of white smoke rose straight up beside it. The fading light gave the smoke a soft and cloudy look. "Do you know what that smoke is?" Midori asked me without warning. "No idea," I said. "They're burning sanitary napkins." "No kidding." I couldn't think of anything else to say. Yeah. Okay, this is Norwegian Wood by Haruki Murakami. I'm actually very, very skeptical of his stuff. Like, as in, I read one book of his and I was intensely critical of it. It was another book, I forget. I think it was IQ 84. I didn't like it, so I picked this one. I picked it because I like his descriptions a lot. Like, they're very, very... what's the right word? Unique, and something different than the usual. So yeah.
So this is our literature wall, strict alphabetical, like the old store. The only thing we've changed recently is over here against the west wall, our books that are priced from $1 to $3. Most of it are, you know, they're mostly $10 to $25 books. But you know, we give people a break, and it moves things along, and it enables us to make room in the store for other things. And it's actually proved to be quite a very popular section already, and we've only been here roughly 10 or 11 days.
The man who appeared to be the leader of the group spoke to one of the others. "Leave him. He doesn't have anything else. He must have stolen this gold." The boy fell to the sand, nearly unconscious. The leader shook him and said, "We're leaving." But before they left, he came back to the boy and said, "You're not going to die. You'll live. You'll learn that a man shouldn't be so stupid. 2 years ago, right here on this spot, I had a recurrent dream too. I dreamed that I should travel to the fields of Spain and look for a ruined church where shepherds and their sheep slept. In my dream, there was a sycamore growing out of the ruins of the sacristy, and I was told that if I dug at the roots of the sycamore, I would find a hidden treasure. But I'm not so stupid as to cross an entire desert just because of a recurrent dream." And they disappeared. The boy stood up shakily, looked once more at the pyramids. They seemed to laugh at him, and he laughed back, his heart bursting with joy, because now he knew where his treasure was. So that's from The Alchemist by Paulo Coelho. And I picked it up because my boss told me to read it, because he said it was a particularly good book. And the reason I loved it so much is that it was very simple and talks about finding sort of your strength or the truth of life within yourself.
I'm going to read a passage from Wind in the Willows by Kenneth Graham, one of the top 1,000 books that I like to reread once in a while. This is a scene where Rat and Mole meet on the riverbank, and for the first time ever, Mole discovers what a boat is. The rat sculled smartly across and made fast. Then he held up his forepaw as the mole stepped gingerly down. "Lean on that," he said. "Now then, step lively." And the mole, to his surprise and rapture, found himself actually seated in the stern of a real boat. "This has been a wonderful day," said he, as the rat shoved off and took to the sculls again. "Do you know, I've never been in a boat before in all my life." "What?" cried the rat, open mouthed. "Never been in a... You've never... Well, I... Well, what have you been doing, then?" "Is it so nice as all that?" asked the mole shyly, though he was quite prepared to believe it is, or it... believe it as he leant back in his seat and surveyed the cushions, the oars, the rowlocks, and all the fascinating fittings, and felt the boat sway lightly under him. "Nice. It's the only thing," said the water rat solemnly, as he leaned forward for his stroke. "Believe me, my young friend, there is nothing, absolutely nothing, half so much worth doing as simply messing about in boats. Simply messing," he went on dreamily, "messing about in boats."